us weighing in on today's show, we have Marcus Pakiser from Young's Columbia, and he is like a sake guru here in the United States. And Marcus, tell us a little bit about how you got involved with sake.
I started working for a company called Hakushika Sake in 1992. And I guess I should say, prior to that, I lived in Japan from 88 to 90. Didn't know anything about sake, but I learned how to speak Japanese. So when I came back, I lived in Colorado, and they built a brewery while I was gone, and they were looking to hire someone that could speak Japanese because their brewmaster couldn't speak English. And they knew they wouldn't find an American that knew about sake, so they just looked for someone that could speak Japanese. So right place, right time, they hired me to brew sake every day, learning how to do it in Japanese, and that's how I got started about 1992.
Fantastic. You know, sake in America, we have to overcome this big thing. A lot of people drink their sake warm, and it's like any beverage. The warmer it is, the more flaws are hidden by the temperature. Same with sake. Sake's best served chilled, and there's some amazing sakes. I'm blessed living here in Portland and having in Forest Grove Momokawa sake plant. And I actually, a brewer, I should say, and I take some of my guests out there. Some people like sake, some people don't. I'm a big fan. Of course, I love sushi, sashimi, and all that other stuff. But Marcus, can you tell us a little bit about some of the brewing? Okay, so there are three or four different kinds of milled grain that goes in, milled rice that goes into sake.
Well, there's different levels of milling degrees. So you have a grain of rice, and the best ultimate type of rice uses a sake, a rice grain grown specifically for sake brewing.
Okay.
But you take the rice and you polish it away. You take off the outer part, which is the fats and proteins. And you want to remove that to where you have just a stark center. Then the more you polish it down, the higher quality sake that you can achieve. So if you polish it down to where 50% or more has been removed, so you have less than 50% there remaining, that's what's called a daiginjo sake. If you go between 50 and 60% polish, so I'll give you an example. This sake right here is a 55% polish.
Okay.
So 45% of the grain is removed, 55% remains. That's a ginjo sake. And then you have a lot of other categories, but a lot of it's all determined upon how much you polish the rice.
Okay. Now, it's my understanding that there's only one yeast that goes into brewing sake?
No, not necessarily.
Okay, here we go.
There are hundreds of types of yeast that can be used for sake brewing. There's yeast that's good for ginjo brewing. There's yeast that's good for solid, really earthy style, sturdy, hearty sake. There's some sakes that have two types of yeast in the same brew. There's some sakes that use flower yeast, like from a garden, you know. Not flour you make bread with,
sure.
But flowers.
I didn't know anything about
in
sake.
The garden. There's also a new sake that I now carry that's made from apple yeast. And I know of one brewery that actually, and this is in the 1940s, they researched 2,000 different styles of yeast on these different slants that they use to just create different types of yeast for sake. And there's a brewing, National Brewing Research Center in Japan, that's all they do is work yeast within the country. So yeast is an up-and-coming, crazy just thing. But a lot of sake within the sake itself either has one type of yeast or generally two types used in one brew.
Okay. Tell us a little bit more about the sake. You know, some of it like this is completely clear, and then you have, of course, you have some sediment in some of this other sake. So the process is the same.
Okay, so basic process, let's just go through that a little bit.
Okay.
So you polish the rice, you wash the rice, then you steep the rice. And the reason for steeping the rice is you need to get it to a certain moisture content. Generally, you want to shoot for about, I think it's a 32% moisture content before you steam.
Okay.
And the reason for that is you want it to be able to, when it's steamed, you still want it to be soft enough that it's going to dissolve slowly in the fermentation tank. But if it's too soft and too mushy, it dissolves too quickly.
Okay.
So you going for an optimal 31-32% moisture content before you brew with it. So that's why you steam the rice. And when you steam the rice, you're going to either make regular steamed rice or you're going to make steamed rice and put a mold spore on top of it. And that's when you make koji. Koji is basically the enzyme that transforms the starch of the rice into glucose. So if you're beer brewing, think of it like malt. because malt transforms it to where it's a fermentable sugar.
Okay.
So then you have koji, you have rice, you have the water, of course, and then you have the yeast added, and that's those four elements together. So it's a dual fermentation process. So you have starch from the rice, but yeast can't convert starch to alcohol.
Correct.
So the koji is in there converting the starch to glucose, while the yeast is in there turning the glucose into alcohol. And it does that for about anywhere from 3 weeks to 40 days, 42 days, depending on what you're making.
Okay. One thing with sake, I know that it doesn't last a long time. It's best consumed younger and fresher, correct? Most sakes for the American palate.
Well,
it doesn't age. There's no tannin structure to age
a
sake.
There's really not a vintage sake per se. So after it's been bottled, it's best to consume it within about a year to 18 months.
Okay.
But that being said, after you've opened a bottle of sake, the bottle will be good for another 4, sometimes 5 months, no problem.
No kidding.
I had a sake last night that had been open in my fridge for 8 months. We drank it, like it tasted like it was just open yesterday.
Wow.
So it does not go bad quickly after you've opened it. But yet, on the other hand, you want to think of it like a beer where you want to consume within a year or so of production.
Where do you think the trends are going forward in America with sake?
Well, I hope they continue like what's happened in Oregon. This has become the number one sake market per capita in the country.
I've heard that.
And you'll find premium sake all over the place. So I would love to see the rest of the U.S. understand premium chilled sake by the glass and get away from doing only hot stuff.
Sure.
Now, another little aspect of it, there are some sake that are good if you warm them up gently. Those are earthier, more tamer sake. But the light, aromatic, ginjo, delicate sakes, you never want to warm. It'd be like boiling your Pinot Gris or your Chardonnay before you drink it.
Yeah, not very appetizing at all. Wow, fantastic. Well, today, Marcus, there's an event here with Young's is putting on, and we're at the Governor Hotel, and it's going to be great. There's a bunch of different sakes in the inside. We're going to go take some video of that as well. But Marcus, thank you so much for stopping
by.
Or having me stop by. Heck, you're here. And I wish you the best of success. It was good to see you again this year.
Kanpai.
All right. Kanpai.
All right.